everyone. My name is Nidhi Chappell, and I lead the Azure HPC and AI product team. Today, I'm excited to talk to you about our AI strategy and what Microsoft is doing to enable AI at scale for all of our customers. With the explosion of data and availability of large cloud compute, the AI community has made significant strides in many areas like speech recognition, computer vision, natural language understanding. Over the last many years, we have seen the emergence of a new training approach called self-supervised learning, where AI models can learn from large amounts of unlabeled data. These models are able to learn on their own. For example, in the space of NLP, the model can learn and understand language constructs by reading immense amount of data that is available on the internet. The more data it reads, the better it understands how words relate to each other in a certain context. Besides just the data it is able to read, the size of these models determines its ability to learn and encode the complexity of the language. In February, Microsoft announced Turing, which is a 17 billion parameter language model that outpaced the state of the art on many downstream NLP tasks. At Microsoft, we are using these massive models to build intelligent solutions into a wide variety of products like Xbox, Bing, Office, enabling new experiences that were not possible till now. What's immediately apparent is to be successful in a world where the requirements of training such large, state-of-the-art AI models are growing so much faster than the capabilities of the raw hardware available to AI researchers on-premise, we need a dramatically different approach, a supercomputing approach like no other. And this is precisely our vision at Microsoft. We want everyone to have access to the same state-of-the-art AI tools, whether from Microsoft or from outside, and have access to big clusters of machines of specialized AI accelerators that are interconnected by high memory bandwidth networks, both inside and outside the machines. These AI supercomputers are what we are building in Azure and are now available to all of our end customers. Our Azure AI supercomputers rival the top 5 supercomputers and are really accelerating the pace of innovation outside of the supercomputing centers. A point in case is OpenAI. As you know, we have been partnering very closely with OpenAI. They recently released a new model called GPT-3, which is trained on Azure supercomputing infrastructure. GPT-3 has really pushed the limits of NLP models with 175 billion parameters. And by doing so, has opened many new capabilities that were not possible before. Today, I am joined by Christopher Berner, the head of compute at OpenAI, to talk about the experiences with Azure supercomputing. Chris, thank you for your partnership. Can you share some insights into OpenAI's vision for GPT-3?
Yeah, certainly. I'm really excited about GPT-3 because I see it as a big milestone in language models. It, of course, is one of the largest and most capable language models that's been trained. And one of the things that I find most exciting about it is its performance on zero-shot tasks, meaning how well it does on a task that has never seen before and hasn't been trained to do well on. And this is an ability that I feel like unlocks a new way of using AI and language models, and we've in fact started building an API around it, which is open to developers everywhere. By using the API, developers are able to easily integrate GPT-3 into their applications, and it also allows us some degree of control and monitoring of GPT-3 to make sure it's not misused.
What do you think were some of the key challenges that you had to overcome when you were designing for models at this scale?
One of the major challenges that we faced training GPT-3 was getting all of the distributed training infrastructure right. We've been using distributed training approaches in AI for quite a while, But for the most part, that's been data parallel approaches, and given the sheer size of GPT-3 at 175 billion parameters, we needed to develop new model parallel approaches to train it. The reason that this is required is that even if you used only 32 bits of data for each parameter in GPT-3, that would be 700 gigabytes of data and doesn't even count temporary variables for things like activations or training data inputs.
Chris, can you talk about some of the infrastructure challenges that you had to overcome?
Yeah, for sure. I'm happy to talk about the infrastructure challenges. Because I think that this is an area where the challenges can be a little bit surprising, even. There's been a lot of focus in the industry on AI accelerators in the last few years, but I feel like the focus has been too heavily on the chips themselves and not enough on the cluster interconnect and the software that's required for really pushing AI at scale to the next level. And the reason that I say that is because these really large language models and really any other type of AI at scale, they're becoming much more like a classic HPC workload, where you have a single synchronous job running on thousands of GPUs. And in our particular case of GPT-3, we saw a really big benefit from switching to the InfiniBand interconnect. And this is something that we built in our new Azure hybrid supercomputer. And we got well over a 50% improvement in performance just out of the box. Going and making further algorithmic improvements is going to lead to even bigger gains. But right out of the gate, we saw a big speed up there. And then on the software side of things, it's similarly very challenging. As these jobs get bigger and bigger, you run into all of the classic distributed systems challenges around needing to solve fault tolerance, issues of tail latency and stragglers, and everything else that comes along with building a distributed training system that runs at the scale of hundreds or thousands of servers. Beyond NLP, another area where there are really interesting infrastructure challenges is in our RL workloads. For example, we have a system that we built and used for some of our projects like Dota and our robotics work on solving a Rubik's Cube with a robotics hand. And RL workloads are really interesting because they have a significantly different training paradigm than in the kind of supervised or unsupervised training approaches that are used in NLP and other tasks. And the main difference is that from a systems perspective, you don't have just a single tier of GPU servers. Instead, you have the GPU servers that are doing optimization, just like in any other workload, but you also have this tier of machines that are running the environment. And in the case of our robotics projects, that might be a physics simulator, which can be extremely compute intensive on its own. And so when we built our hybrid supercomputer with Azure, not only did we have 10,000 V100s, but we also built a very large cluster of CPU servers using the HBV2 SKU that has AMD ROM cores. We have a 250,000 CPUs there because of the number of RL environments that we need to run. A single job might use 100,000 CPU cores just for running physics simulators. And so you have the setup where the GPU tier of machines are doing optimization, sending actions to the physics simulators, and then getting back responses as to what happened, which then drives the next iteration of the optimization loop. So to tie that back to what I was saying earlier about the main challenges being in cluster interconnect and software stack, in both the case of reinforcement learning workloads and training these really large language models, you need this huge distributed cluster and then have a very challenging software system that needs to get built to handle all of the fault tolerance across thousands of GPUs, plus potentially 100,000 or even more CPU cores.
Chris, can you talk about some of the examples of use cases that are now possible for developers using GPT-3?
Before I jump into that, I'll just wrap up another thought about the infrastructure and challenges of bringing up this hybrid supercomputer, because I think that's a fun story too. the whole cluster really came together in less than a year's time, and I thought that was a great show of the partnership between Azure and OpenAI, and how we were able to bring people from a classic supercomputer and HPC background together with our research scientists and build a cluster that was so well optimized for AI workloads. And the result of that, GPT-3 and all of the innovative things that our developers have come up with have just really amazed me. I feel like every week I see innovative things that developers have done with the API. Some of my favorites have been things like interactive storytelling and also code generation. Coming from a background as a programmer, I find that very exciting, where people have built JavaScript and React app generators where you just put in the name of a component or function and it can autocomplete dozens of lines of JavaScript code and HTML. So things like that just really amaze me.
This is so exciting. Chris, what's next for OpenAI?
I think what's next and what excites me is that this feels like just a whole new way of interacting with computers. You know, it used to be that we wrote assembly or C or whatever, and you would have to use that to talk to a computer. But now, with these new language models, you can just interact with them in natural language, just talk to them in English, and the computer can then continue generating your poetry or homework assignment or whatever, and I'm sure it's a much better poet than I am. And so I see this really as the next step in our interaction with computers, and how this will empower not only the developers to be more productive, but I really see this as potentially unlocking the next 10 million or 100 million developers and poets and writers, and allowing people to do things that they couldn't have done on their own by having this new way of just collaborating with a computer and integrating it into your creative process.
Thank you, Chris. We're proud to show our partnership with OpenAI and believe that AI in the right hands has the potential to change the world for better. And that's why we are committed to making the same fundamental hardware used by OpenAI at scale of thousands of GPUs available to any Azure customer. Today, I'm excited to announce that we now have NVIDIA A100 GPUs widely available for all of our customers to use. The largest A100 cluster in Azure features more than 6,000 GPUs, each with a fully subscribed 200 gigabit per second InfiniBand HDR link, which means a staggering 1.2 petabits per second of bisectional bandwidth. Not to mention the ability to do GPU direct RDMA at full PCIe Gen 4 speeds, paired with the latest AMD Rom processors. Each Azure supercluster would rank easily among the top 10 supercomputers on Earth if measured today. Innovators like OpenAI, or whoever will be behind the next breakthrough in AI, cannot accept substitutes as we race towards the next breakthrough in healthcare, clean energy, education, or for that matter, just picking a movie the whole family can agree on. So we are here to turn the problem of doing AI at scale into a real deployable solution. Thank you.